is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are, to worship. Come, just as you are before your God.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. So glad that you have joined us today, and I know that so many of you are gathered together in your living rooms or wherever you are able to watch this virtual worship service. And we just want to know that the team that is gathered here at our church facility and is providing this opportunity, it is our prayer that you truly might experience an encounter with the living God this morning as we gather together in this virtual format. There are several things I want to remind you of today before we move into the formal part of our worship service. First of all, today is Communion Sunday, and so I invite you at some point between now and the end of the sermon to gather the elements for yourself, whatever those might be that represent the bread and the wine that we find in the communion elements, to grab those and have them ready following the sermon today. Also, two Sundays from today is our annual Charge Conference. Now, Charge Conference is the conference each year where we vote on a number of matters relative to the future of the church, new officers, the budget, things like that. It is particularly pertinent if you are an office holder here at the church, one of our elected officers. This year, that is going to be done via Zoom. Zoom is a virtual meeting application that we use on our computers. My word to you today, if you're not familiar with Zoom or need a little help figuring out how Zoom works, please let us know so that we can help you be prepared for Charge Conference 2 weeks from today on October 18th. We're working hard to get that all in place. Also, I realize that most of you are aware that we are beginning to take our steps forward to begin to offer once again in-person worship here in the church sanctuary. That is still a work in progress. Here's what I want to tell you today. First of all, before the month of October is gone, we will be providing an in-person live worship experience here in the sanctuary. We have already begun the steps to that end. The sanctuary is being prepared and sanitized and marked off for appropriate social distancing. That's still a work in progress. We are still all getting that all ready. We expect by the end of the week for that to be in place. So here's a couple of opportunities. First of all, this upcoming Wednesday, actually the next two Wednesdays, at 5:30 in the afternoon, we're going to provide a fellowship opportunity. It will be outdoors in the courtyard out front of Van Dyken Hall, and it's simply a time to come and begin to reconnect with each other face to face. As with all of these events, for some of you, you may not be ready to take that step. We want you to know that we love and respect wherever you're at in that question. But for those who are ready to come, The next two Wednesday evenings will provide a fellowship opportunity outdoors in the courtyard out front of Van Dyken Hall. We look forward to seeing you for those. Also, you can help us. Next week, possibly the next 2 weeks, we will continue to be doing virtual worship only. However, the sanctuary will be open and ready for you to return. And so while we'll be doing virtual worship from the sanctuary, we would invite any of you who wish to do so to come and observe our virtual worship service and then to give us some feedback on the preparations that you observe while we're here. This will enable us to make sure that we don't miss anything important as we begin to worship live in the sanctuary. So next Sunday, we do invite you to come, if you wish to do so, and simply observe our worship service, while at the same time giving us some feedback on what you observe and what your experience is and what we can do to make the live worship experience that we're moving toward as effective and as safe as we know how to make it. As I said before, the month is out, we'll be providing that opportunity here in the sanctuary. Once we return to in-person worship, we are still going to provide a streaming virtual online worship experience as well. What can you be doing besides what I've just described to you? Well, please pray. As you can imagine, restarting something after doing things so differently for so long takes a little bit of doing, and it's going to require your help. So consider coming and joining us next Sunday or the Sunday after, even if we're not fully worshiping in the sanctuary yet. Also, we are going to need you to consider serving as an usher, as a greeter, as someone who can help out in the sound booth. And even if you're not familiar with what those tasks are involved, trust me, we're more than happy to show you how to do it. And so as we come back together, just know there is a place for each and every one of us to help make it happen. With that in mind, I just want to welcome you once again to worship and ask for you to join me in this historic affirmation that describes the faith that we all share and around which we gather this day. Hear and read these words together with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, and he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's lift our hearts and our voices to the Lord in praise this day.
Oh, happy day that fixed my choice on thee, my Savior and my God. Well, may this glowing heart rejoice and tell its raptures all abroad. Happy day, happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. He taught me how to watch and pray and live rejoicing every day. Happy day, happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. 'Tis done, the great transaction's done. I am my Lord's and he is mine. He drew me and I followed on, rejoiced to own the call divine. Happy day, happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. He taught me how to watch and pray and live rejoicing every day. Happy day, happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away.
Good morning. Please join us in reading the call to worship, today using scripture from Psalm 145. Great is the Lord, and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made. All your works praise you, Lord. Your faithful people extol you. They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might, so that all people may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is trustworthy in all he promises and faithful in all he does.
Well, good morning to all of our younger worshipers. Be you young in age or young at heart, we always like to take a few moments at this point in our service just to particularly address you and talk to you and share by way of an object or two a lesson that you might find helpful in a better understanding just how much God loves you. This morning, I've got a couple of things with me, one of which is this, bread, a loaf of bread. This one's a little bit on the small side, but typically when you see a loaf of bread in the store, it's a little larger. But I have bread with me today. The other thing is a picture of a tree, a very large tree, as it turns out to be, and a tree that is a tree that we know as the mustard tree. Now, my question for you is this morning, what do a tree and bread possibly have in common? How are they alike? Well, they're alike in this way. Both of them start from something very, very small. Let's talk about the tree for a moment, okay? This big old tree, particularly the mustard tree, starts from something extremely small. I have with me some seeds this morning, very small seeds. In fact, they'd be very almost impossible to see were I not to hold them up to the camera for you. These are seeds the size of a mustard tree seed, very, very small. And in order to get this great big mustard tree, you have to have a very small mustard seed to plant in order to get it. Now, what about the bread? Well, let's talk about the bread this morning. You see, bread requires something very, very small as well. And I brought some of that today as well. It's called yeast. And this yeast powder is required to go into the bread dough to help the bread dough rise so that it can be cooked and become the loaf of bread so that you and I can eat it and make sandwiches from it and all that stuff. But the yeast that goes into the bread is quite small. And it's a very small amount of yeast that you use to make a big loaf of bread. What's my point this morning? Well, as I said, both the bread and the tree require something very, very small to start. You know, Jesus talked about that in the Bible. Jesus said that if we have faith as small as a mustard seed, we could potentially move whole mountains. What was he talking about? Well, sometimes, I don't know about you, but my faith seems very, very weak and very, very small, just like the mustard seed or the yeast. But the point of Jesus telling that story was to help us understand that it's not so important the quantity of our faith, but who or what we trust in our faith. And when we trust in Jesus, when we trust in someone, even though our faith might be small, when we trust in someone so big as Jesus and as God, we're trusting in someone who can do a whole lot more than you and I could do on our own. Something to think about today. Father, I thank you for each young person that is with us today, this opportunity to worship together. And Father, help us to trust you. I know sometimes it seems like we just have so little faith, but you, because we can place that little bit of faith in you, it becomes something very, very big. And we thank you for these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And now we come to a time of prayer when we can approach the throne of the Father. Before we begin, I'd like to lift up Bill Hartley and Carmen Silva, two of our members who have been discharged, but pray for their continued healing, as well as for Barb Hartley, who remains in rehab. As always, we will begin with a moment of silence so that we can each individually bring our specific concerns and thanks before the Lord. Please join me in prayer. Father God, we read in the beginning of Genesis, of the creation story, and all the things, all the wonder of creation that you made, and it was all good, and you gave it to us, and we are thankful. And if we look outside and in our world and we truly look for it, for the signs, we can see it, dear Lord, and we are thankful. We're thankful for the sun and the warmth and the light that it gives us. We're thankful for the rain and how it quenches our thirst and refreshes us. We're thankful for the beauty of the oceans and the resources that they supply. And we're thankful for the beauty of the land and the trees and what they do for us. We're thankful for the mountains and their majesty, and we're thankful for the valleys and the wonderful things that we see in them. And we're thankful when we climb the mountains and get to see the glory, dear Lord, and we're thankful even when we are in the valley because we know that you are with us. And along with these thanks, dear Lord, we bring confessions. We confess that we haven't always loved you with all that we have, Lord. Instead, loving our things of the world over you. We confess, dear Lord, that we put our desires above the needs of others, putting ourselves, therefore, above them. We put ourselves in your place at times, dear Lord, judging others instead of allowing that to you. And for all of these things, dear Lord, we offer our sorrow. We offer them to you, dear Lord, and we ask for your forgiveness and grace. We also come to you with many concerns, dear Lord. Many things that weigh on our hearts and minds. And really it comes down to two things that we're asking for, Father. Healing and peace. We ask for healing for those who are suffering from illness or injury or disease. And we ask for peace, that they know that you are with them and that it will be okay. We ask for healing for loved ones who are helping those who are injured or who have lost loved ones. And we ask for the peace of mind of knowing that you're with them and that the loved ones are in fact with you. We ask for healing and peace for our nation, dear Lord, for our world. Healing of the wars that trouble our cities and our communities and our nations. Peace for all of mankind. We offer these things, dear Lord, knowing that when we ask, you provide. And we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen indeed. Thank you once again for participating in our worship today. We're so glad you're here, and I know some of you have invited a friend or a family member to join us during this virtual time. We want you to know we consider each and every one of you part of our extended Mariner family. We're glad you're here. Thank you as well for your faithfulness in supporting the church through tithes and offerings. I know it may seem over the course of these weeks that we've been somewhat dormant, and while it's true we've had to limit some ministries due to the social restrictions placed upon us to keep everyone safe, we recognize the fact that the work of the church continues in any way possible that we can do it. And as we begin to plan for and implement an in-person worship experience in addition to our virtual one, obviously we're going to continue to rely upon God's people to sustain the work through our tithes and offerings. So I want to thank you for your faithfulness and encourage you to continue to be faithful. You can be faithful in a variety of ways, certainly by sending your check for your tithes and offerings by U.S. mail to the church, dropping it by the church office and either leaving it in the office or in the drop box immediately outside the office doors, or by using the online giving electronic means that is provided for you on the church website at marinerumc.org, marinerumc.org. Lots of information on the website that's very current, including recordings of these messages, online giving links to the Florida Department of Health and United Methodist Church to help each of us stay informed and connected during these days. Allow me to pray God's blessing upon each tithe and offering and upon each person who offers those this day. Father, we thank you for the faithfulness of your people. Father, we continue to live through unprecedented times, but Lord, we have found you to be faithful in so many ways. And as a statement of our love for you and to continue the work of expanding your kingdom, we pray in the name of Jesus that you would bless these tithes and these offerings to your glory and to your work. We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, worship his holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the day is done. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship your holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Praise God from whom blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
As we come to this part of our worship experience, we'll return our hearts and thoughts to the Holy Scriptures. I'd like to take a moment and pray once again that God would just enlighten our minds and hearts and open us to what he would have to say to each of us this day. I realize that the Bible is a book with one primary story, but as we relate that story to our individual lives, it has the capacity to speak to us in very much and very, very personal ways as well. So with that in mind, allow me to ask God to enable us this day to understand and apply his word that he has for us. Father, once again, thank you for this opportunity to gather for worship. Whether it be here in our church sanctuary or whether it be in our living rooms or kitchen table or wherever we have gathered from this day, we thank you that we can come before you and know that you are here, you are with us. And we know that it is by the power of your Holy Spirit that you enlighten our minds and hearts to better understand and apply your scriptures to our lives. And to that end, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, everyone loves a good story. One of the ways, typically, when society is kind of running on a normal way, whatever normal might mean, we go to the movies to see a good story. Right now, we've been unable to do that. We can't quite, because of social distancing guidelines and such, a number of the theaters are yet to open, or if they're open, they're open on a very limited basis. And if they're open, there may only be a few of us who may be willing to take the step of actually attending a movie. So like you, and like many of us during this time, my wife and I, when we want to see a good story, we will watch it on our television set via Netflix or Amazon Video or some other service that is providing a film that we would like to see. Why? Because everybody loves a good story. We all need times to just hear a story, particularly stories of significance. I think that's why Jesus so often, when he wanted to make a point, told a story. What is the stories that Jesus taught were called parables. And a parable is pretty simply this. It's a story that illustrates the unknown with something that is known. Let's face it, spiritual truth is sometimes hard to get our heads around. God is a big God, and his truth is a big truth, and sometimes it's hard to comprehend its significance for us, and so God understands that, Jesus understands that, and so often when Jesus wanted to make a point, he told a story about something we could relate to that in some way, shape, or form would help us better understand the bigger spiritual truth that he wanted us to know. There are two parables in particular we're going to read today. Both relate to the kingdom of God. We are a part of a series that we're simply calling Tales of the Kingdom. And these stories, once again today, give us a little further insight into that which Jesus said he came to preach, to teach, and to usher in, and that is the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. Allow me to read these words from the book of Matthew. These are from Matthew chapter 13, beginning in verse 31. Matthew chapter 13, beginning in verse 31. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in the field. And though it is the smallest of all seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds come and perch in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 60 pounds of flour until it worked its way all through the dough. Jesus spoke all these things to the crowd in parables, and he did not say anything to them without using a parable. So was fulfilled what was spoken through the prophet. I will open my mouth in parables, and I will utter things hidden since the creation of the world. As I mentioned, a parable is a story or a description that Jesus used to describe something that we could identify with in order to better understand a larger spiritual truth that if we didn't have the story or the description, would be difficult for us to get our heads around. And so that was one of the primary reasons why Jesus used parables to teach his people and to teach you and I today as well. He also used parables because, well, it was a fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies that foretold how the Messiah would come and how he would function when he did come. And one of the things that was foretold about the coming Messiah and was fulfilled in Jesus is that when he taught with parables. I'm so glad that he does, because apart from some of these stories, I don't think we'd really understand God in the way that I know he wishes us to. Today, the two parables that I read help us understand a couple of very, very important things about the kingdom of heaven, about the kingdom of God. The first of these is simply this, that that the kingdom has very small beginnings, seemingly insignificant. The second of the parable reminds us that the kingdom of God is something that penetrates everywhere. It has great effect when it is properly built. Putting those two parables together, allow me this day to offer to you three thoughts at least about what these parables teach us about the kingdom of God for you and I this day. The first thing I would like to suggest from this parable, probably pretty obvious by now, but nevertheless important to know, is that with the kingdom of God, its beginnings seem absolutely impossible. The beginnings seem impossible. Allow me to go back to our seeds again. Our mustard seeds, extremely small. Now, we know in this day of microscopes and technology, we can see seeds that are actually smaller than the mustard seed. But for the people of Jesus' day, the mustard seed was about the smallest of seeds that they could see with the naked eye. And Jesus used the mustard seed to tell us that in the beginning, the kingdom of God just seems like something it's impossible to expect. It's just a pipe dream. It's just something we wish could happen, but never will, because all we really see is a very, very small beginning. Just like the farmer who plants to plant a mustard seed puts a very small seed in the ground with great expectations that that seed will grow. The beginnings seem so unlikely and so impossible that something as significant as the kingdom of God could grow from something so small. We can apply that in our everyday lives too. Sometimes our acts of kindness or our words of encouragement or a scripture passage we share with a friend or encouraging someone who does not yet know the saving grace of God that they can experience through Jesus Christ. When we explain Jesus to them and how they can experience life abundant and life eternal with him, all these things seem at the time so very, very, very small, almost to the point where we wonder at times, is it even real? I mean, will God bless? The beginnings just seem so impossible. Right now, as we are making preparations to enter again into a season where we can provide an in-person worship service here in the church, I can tell you from my perspective at least, it seems like an impossible task. After so many months of socially restricting ourselves, kind of restarting things and getting our volunteer teams together and preparing the sanctuary in such a way that we can provide a safe environment for that to happen, there are so many seemingly extremely small tasks, but extremely important tasks in order that we may take this further step in continuing to build and expand God's kingdom. So one of these things that we learn from these stories is the beginnings do seem impossible. But don't let that dissuade you from helping to build the kingdom in whatever small way you might do. The beginnings seem impossible. You know why? Because God never wastes a seed. There is never a seed that is sowed for the sake of the kingdom that God in some way, shape, or form will not water and bless, even though we may never see the results. Sometimes the beginnings of the kingdom seem absolutely impossible. But additionally, according to these parables, what I see here is that while the beginnings seem impossible, the growth is often invisible. We often don't get to see the growth of the kingdom. You see, in an earthly kingdom, it's pretty visible. In medieval times, or even in Jesus' times, kings lived in palaces. Kings lived in castles. There were lands and stockpiles of resources. There was gold and there was pomp and there was circumstance. And there were all kinds of markers of the earthly kingdom that were made to represent the power and the extent of the kingdom and to draw attention to the power of the king or the power of the queen that happened to be ruling at the time. But in the case of God's kingdom, the growth often seems so invisible. It's growth that we don't see. Why is that? Well, it's that way because God's kingdom is so different from any worldly kingdom. And while the idea of a kingdom gives us some thought, we have to understand that God's kingdom, be the present kingdom or the full experience of that kingdom in the life to come, is quite different than an earthly kingdom. Why is that? Because God numbers his kingdom by the number of hearts that are his. Not by the number of buildings, not by the stockpile of resources, not by castles, not by lands, not by all the typical markers. God counts human hearts that belong to him. People that have entered into a relationship with him through Jesus Christ and are now a part of the family of God. They are now children of the king. And God numbers his kingdom by the number of hearts, not by all the visible signs. And even here in the Church of Jesus Christ, we recognize that we too, we have buildings and foyers and we have methodologies and things we use to help build the king. But at the end of the day, those are not the kingdom. The kingdom is you. The kingdom is me. The kingdom of our hearts that have been surrendered in full to the king, to our Lord Jesus Christ. That is why so often growth is invisible. You can see its results, but you cannot see the growth of the spirituality of a human heart, but God sees it, and the Holy Spirit sees it. So please know and please trust that God is faithful. Even though the beginnings of the kingdom seem so impossible, and even though growth is often invisible, God's kingdom is very, very real. Finally, I would leave this thought with you regarding the kingdom of God. Not only are the beginnings seemingly impossible, not only is growth often invisible, but the results are incredible. Wow, this is what we live for. This is what we want to see. Once again, I want to come back, not to the seeds, but to our yeast. I did a little research, and for those of you that are cooks and bakers, I realize that this is kind of like, you know, broad brush, that quantities can vary, and I know there's some of you much more expert than I. But I looked up how much yeast it takes to make one loaf of bread. And it was interesting, in our parable today, this person that's cooking it is planning to make 60 loaves of bread. Now, 60 loaves of bread, you would imagine, would take up a great amount of yeast. And she would be on a yeast hunt to make sure that she has enough yeast to make all 60 loaves of bread. Au contraire, according to at least what I looked at, it only takes about 1 teaspoon of yeast for a pound of bread, which means she's only going to need 60 teaspoons, not 60 pounds of yeast. And the point being is that even though the yeast is a very small amount, the results are pretty incredible, because we go from a very small amount of yeast to a very big loaf of bread, and a very small quantity of yeast is all that is necessary to produce the bread. 1 pound of flour requires only 1 teaspoon of yeast. So you see, the results of the yeast are pretty amazing. It's a loaf of bread for you and I to eat. Sometimes we forget that the kingdom of God is something that is so real that we look for results in the wrong place. But the results of the kingdom, compared to the seeds that we sow, compared to the amount of yeast required, the results are incredible. And that's where we need to listen to each other's stories. We need to take time to hear how the kingdom of God has penetrated our hearts, how we've experienced God sometimes in our darkest of days, and how we've experienced God in the most wonderful of times. Because the kingdom of God is present within us in both of those. And as the yeast is sown into our lives of the kingdom of God, and it begins to penetrate each and every aspect of our lives, the results of that seed sown are absolutely incredible. I am blessed as a pastor to hear a number of those stories. And in the days and weeks ahead, I look forward to hearing some of your stories, particularly stories over these last few unprecedented and difficult times, of where you have found God to be faithful to his work in your heart and in my heart and all of our hearts together. Thank you this morning for joining us for worship. In just a moment, we're going to transition and remind ourselves of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ that allows this worship experience to be all that it is. But allow me to pray now and ask God to apply the truth of his kingdom to our hearts and to our lives. Father, thank you for this opportunity to turn to your word. And we pray that, Lord, as we better understand it and apply it to our lives, that our hearts might be fully yours, that we might be fully complete in you, and that, Father, we might not only recognize that as children of the King, we have an incredible opportunity to experience life with you, and we have an incredible story to share with others. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we conclude our worship today by receiving together Holy Communion, I would like to simply remind us all that on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. Seated around a table with his 12 closest followers, those that we eventually came to know as the apostles, he broke bread and he distributed that bread around the table. And as the bread was going around the table, he said, "This is not just another loaf of bread, for this particular loaf of bread represents my body, which is about to be given for you. And that from this point forward, as you remember me, please always remember that this bread represents my body given to you. And as often as you eat of it, you should do so in remembrance of me." Immediately after passing the bread to each of those seated around the table, he took a cup and he passed the cup around the table. And he told his closest of followers, his soulmates, if you will, in ministry, that this would be the last time they would drink of the fruit of the vine in this life. But nevertheless, that this cup represented something extremely important. It represents the blood of Jesus Christ, his blood about to be spilled for their sins and for the sins of all humankind from that time forward all the way down to you and I this day. And that often as they should drink of it in the future, they should always and forever always do it in remembrance of him. For those that are here as part of the worship team or visiting today, we have elements prepared for you if you wish to come and partake of them. We invite you to do so at this point. For you that are at home, we invite you to take the bread that we've just spoken of, the bread that we are to eat always and remember in remembrance of Jesus. And to take the bread, and now together, let's eat of the bread, remembering as we do the body of Jesus Christ given for you, given for me, given for us all. Just as Jesus, following the bread, passed the cup around the table, that they might drink of the cup, knowing now that this cup symbolized something that it had never really symbolized before, now symbolized and represented the spiritual presence of Jesus Christ amongst us this day, as we drink together of the cup, remembering as we do the shed blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Father, this day, as we have gathered in your presence to worship you, be it in person or virtually, we thank you that by faith you have been here and continue to be with us each step of the way. Remind us that we are children of the King, and that no matter how small the beginnings of that work may seem in our lives or the lives of our family or the lives of our friend, it is a very real work that we can trust you to grow and to bring from which incredible results to your glory. We pray and offer these things to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name, and in Jesus' name I come to you to share his love as he told me to. He said, "Freely, freely you have received, freely, freely give. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know that I live. God gives us life in Jesus' name. He lives in us in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name I come to you to share his peace as he told me to. He said, freely, freely you have received, freely, freely give. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know that I live.
Once again, so glad you could worship with us today. We'll be posting this week on the website. We'll be emailing, and in any way we know how, providing you with detailed step-by-step plans for regathering in our sanctuary again. Just a reminder that once that happens, we will still be providing a virtual worship opportunity, because we know and respect that some of you are ready to return, some of you not quite. We want you to know that God loves each and every one of you, and we will continue to love each other all through this period of time. To that end, we thank you once again for being with us. Remember, God loves you very, very much.